With us today, we have a special opportunity to talk with one of the flight controllers here in Mission Control Houston, Anthony Vareha. Welcome aboard.
Good to be here.
And Anthony is one of the SPARTAN flight controllers. There have been some changes going on here at Mission Control with a few of the different console positions changing, in particular in your area. Can you tell us a little bit about what SPARTAN stands for and what you do and how things have evolved here in Mission Control in your area?
Okay, the hardest part of that question is what SPARTAN stands for. I think it's Station Power Articulation and Thermal Analysis. It was one of those things where the name sounded cool, and then we kind of filled in the words to make it up. But I started here as a Thor, which is right back over this little divider here. And I started here in 2007 after doing a co-op tour at Kennedy Space Center working on solid rocket booster. So I was straight out of college when I started here. And Thor takes care of all the external thermal as well as the internal thermal, ammonia, cooling, everything that, you know, heaters and pumps, things like that. And eventually, as part of a effort to streamline our operations here, the Thor officer is being kind of devolved into two separate positions, which is the SPARTAN, which I just named, and then the Ethos. So all of the external thermal control goes in with Falcon, which is the electrical systems, whereas all the internal thermal control goes in with what is now called Ethos. And so they that goes along with their life support duties that the Eclus officer used to do. So where once was Falcon, Thor, and Eclus, there is now SPARTAN and Ethos. And so the path I took was the SPARTAN console. Generally, we are in charge at SPARTAN of all the electrical systems, just like Falcon used to be. Big rotating joints, all the 8 solar arrays, and now we've got the external thermal control system on top of that. Generally, if you need to put on a spacesuit to go fix our stuff, then that's a SPARTAN responsibility.
Okay, and that's exactly what Sunny Williams and Aki Hoshide had to do last week. And that's one of the reasons we brought you on today, so you could talk to us a little bit about that spacewalk and what was accomplished by the two spacewalkers, and about how the systems are doing now that the repairs have been made.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, great spacewalk last week. In general, we have a cooling system for each of our solar array sets. There's 8 solar arrays. Each of them has a cooling system because they feed batteries. And as you know from operating a cellular phone, batteries get hot when they start discharging. So we have to keep those batteries cool to keep the lights on and everything running on station. We noticed about sometime middle this year that a very small leak on the 2 Bravo power channel, this is one of our very core power channels, powers a lot of important stuff. We knew we had a little leak there. That leak got a lot bigger this summer. And so we decided, the ISS program decided it was a good idea to go ahead and send our great crew out there who are very familiar with EVAs. This is their third EVA that they did last week. Send them out, fix it, and the way we are going about this is the purpose of last week was to reroute the cooling from the radiator we normally use for the 2B channel to a different radiator. And the reason for that is one of the big reasons why something like a cooling system in space might spring a leak is if a micrometeoroid hit it. Now, there are two main parts of a PVTCS, photovoltaic thermal control system. One's a big long radiator, and one's a little pump. And there's some other tubes in between there that actually cool some stuff, but that's buried underneath some of the other components. Now, if you're going to pick which of those two pieces is most likely to have a hole in it, it's probably the 45-foot long radiator sticking out into space. And so we decided that a first troubleshooting effort would be to go disconnect that radiator, reroute some jumpers over to an old, early external thermal control system, which used to be back before the big long truss got assembled. That was our main cooling system. This is the PVTCS right there. And what that shows is the different little components, including the early ammonia servicer jumpers, and that's what actually we used to reroute the cooling to the old external system. The fluid disconnect coupling, which is how we disconnected the radiator from the rest of the system. Of course, we had to shut the system off to do this. And then you see the photovoltaic radiator, the PVR, and that's what we actually think is leaking. Where this is located is way out on the end of the truss, next to the, it's on P6, the furthest out on the port side. We sent the crew out there to that big long radiator, disconnected it, and deployed a different radiator, an old radiator from the old early external thermal control system. Here's the video of that happening. And so those commands were sent by my backroom, a guy named Dave Crook and his compatriot Rami Aliubi, who were both key to our support of this EVA. And so this was a big team effort from Spartan. We're really proud of the way it came out. Because you know, we haven't sent these radiator commands in years. If I sit in a car for longer than 6 hours, my legs hurt. And here's a radiator that had been bunched up for 6 years and deployed just like it was new.
And the reason we had this radiator is because that P6 truss was the first solar ray generation system we had on the station, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, for a while that's all we had, and so that's where we ran a small ammonia system to cool the U.S. lab, and now we've got the big external thermal control system, what we call the ETCS, as opposed to the early external thermal control system, which is a much bigger system. And so now that we don't need that early system, it was just sitting out there, had ammonia in it, but it wasn't running. Well, the parts still worked on it, as we showed with the radiator, so we had this handy spare radiator that we could hook into, and all it took was these commands to deploy that radiator, in addition to all of the configurations and all of the standard planning that goes into an EVA like what we did last week. System's working great. We're real happy with how for doing that level of reconfiguration of a system that's flying around at 17,500 miles per hour, and for it to go as smoothly as it did last week, is a real testament to all the planning that went in from the ground here, as well as to Sunny and Aki for doing a great job on the EVA. We're going to watch the system for the next couple of months, make sure that we're basically doing a leak check, a very long leak check, and see if we have isolated the leak to that radiator that we cut off. And if that's true, then we might be done. We'll just keep running through this new old radiator for the duration until we need to reconfigure. But system's working great.
Now, people tend to think of space as being a really cold place. And so why would you need a radiator to get rid of extra heat in space?
Great question. So as you, yes, people think of space is being cold, but space is empty. Space doesn't really have a temperature. It's the particles inside space that the errant little molecules of whatever that are floating around that actually have temperature. So it's really just primarily what we deal with is the station and the sun. So the station generates heat by having pumps running, by having electrical power being generated, and the sun is also putting heat onto the station. And we have insulation blankets around a lot of all our components to keep them warm, but you don't want things to get too warm, and so we have to radiate our heat away. There's three ways you can get rid of heat: convection, radiation, and the third one. You don't have any other method of getting rid of heat when you have no working fluid around you other than radiation. So that's why you see these big radiators sticking off the side of the station. That's how we get rid of the excess heat.
Okay, and inside those radiators is ammonia, right?
That's correct, and that's the fluid that we were rerouting last week.
Okay, and then inside the station there's another system that transfers that heat, and you've got a heat exchanger between the ammonia part and the one that's inside, and as I understand it, that one's kind of a water-based system, and that way if you get a leak inside, it's not harmful or poisonous to the crew, right?
That's correct. We run water on the inside, ammonia on the outside, and we like to keep them in those respective places because ammonia, the ammonia we run is a very good coolant, but it is toxic to humans, so we keep it on the outside, and that's why you see people in spacesuits when they're working with it, or if you're working with it on the ground, certainly a lot of safety protection goes into play.
And all of our connections, those quick disconnects that the spacewalkers use, they work really well this time around, and we didn't get a lot of contamination by this.
That's true. You know, we had just a few little flakes come off of the FQDC that we showed earlier, but, that was expected. As you disconnect something, there's just a little pocket of ammonia there. But that was it. I mean, as far as a ammonia EVA, this was a very clean, and the crew did not have to worry about baking off the ammonia so that they didn't bring any inside. We were managed to be able to do that just by having them outside, and the sun will burn off the ammonia.
Okay. And then your discipline has been really busy because not only were you working on this and working on EVA plans and deploying an old radio that hadn't been used for 6 years, but you had another significant power system issue that we thought we might have to do a second EVA for.
We've had a rough couple of months. So You may remember EVA 18 and 19 earlier this fall, where Suni and Aki went out and replaced our main bus switching unit, MBSU-1. And that MBSU had been acting up on us, so we decided it was a good idea to take it out and replace it. When we took it out, we couldn't get it back in because of a stuck bolt. And so for about 6 days, we had cut off access to two of our power channels, 1A and 1B. And those power channels were working fine, but we had no pathway to get the power to us. Now, we can do smart things on the ground by rerouting power, and we actually maintain what we call copper path. We have the ability to turn on anything we want on the station when something like that happens. It just is a resource hit. You know, our power resource officers are trained to distribute the load so that we don't have a brownout or something like that, because we want to make sure that everybody can turn on their payloads and we can keep all the critical systems running. So we fixed that, but in the middle of that, while those two power channels were unavailable, another power channel went down, 3 alpha, and that one had a short. So there was a point at which we were down to 5 out of 8 power channels, but we could still turn anything on. Since then, we, of course, replaced the MBSU on EVA 19. Suni and Aki did a great job there as well. And then with the short, whatever caused the short, it was a very large short. It was an 800-amp short, they're thinking. So whatever might cause that, probably vaporized when it had all that current going through it. So the engineers looked at it. We decided it was safe to turn things back on. We gave it a shot, and sure enough, it's been running fine ever since we turned it back on.
Well, that's great news. So power systems are back stable now, and you're just monitoring the results of this leak to make sure that you don't have another leak with this reroute.
Absolutely. Yeah, we've got 8 good power channels, and we're keeping an eye on 2B to make sure that we don't lose any more fluid from it and see where that leak might be.
Great. Well, Anthony, let's talk a little bit about you, just so folks understand that it takes people from everywhere around this country and the world, for that matter, to operate the International Space Station. Tell us a little bit about where you're from and where you went to school and what you studied to get here.
Sure. Well, I'm from Pittsburgh, actually just outside of Pittsburgh, a place called Monroeville.
Do they have power there now?
They do have power there now. Yes, absolutely. Yes. As people in the Northeast would know, it's not good when you start losing power systems. And so I went to school in Florida at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University and got a degree in engineering physics. It's kind of a degree in space physics. I was always interested in space from an early age, and my mom and dad really encouraged that, bought me a bunch of space books and things like that. And so once I figured out that this was a job, you know, working in this room is something that was attainable, something that is not, this is the kind of job you can actually do straight out of college if you have a good science and engineering background. And so once I found that out, you know, I was doing what I can to get here. I'm very happy that I am here because I started here, as I said, in 2007 and have been really happy doing flight control ever since.
Well, Anthony, so thank you so much for coming on today and help us understand a little bit more about the power systems on the station and how that EVA went and the remaining work done that we have to do to make sure that everything is, the leak is isolated and everything is going to continue to work well. We really appreciate you coming on. We hope you come back and tell us some more good news when we get a chance to finish the analysis of all this. But thanks very much for coming in today.
It's my pleasure. It's really good to... It's really nice to have a chance to talk about all the good work we're doing right down the line there that one of my compatriots sitting on console right now.